Hello, welcome to a big, big block hosted by Joanna Warschauer, and it's very much linked to maybe the last session, to this edgy line between art and crime, to legal and illegal moments in activism. Joanna Warschauer, you have seen her already yesterday. She was co-curator of the Berlin Biennale this year, and she is a cultural producer, I would say, dramaturg, curator, working in the fields of visual arts and performance, having an own, what is called, label production, a foundation, Laura Palmer's Foundation, of course, which is linked to David Lynch, Twin Peaks, and she produces actions in the public sphere, in the public space, which examine social and political agendas, conceptual exhibitions, and participation events and stage situations. So she is hosting a session which is linked to the issue of legal actions and illegal actions, and also not only referring to current actions, as we mostly do have now, but also having this kind of historic view on the tradition and the history of that. So now I want to pass over to Joanna. Thank you very much for making this blog.
Thank you very much, Veronica. Good morning. Thank you for coming. We'll have, as Veronica said, 3 hours blog called Art and Crime Legally on the Edge with different sub-blogs, and we'll try to examine or to look upon certain gray zone between art and legislation and how artists have been employing consciously strategies in order to push the legislation or to try to find a black holes and testing somehow art and criminality. So the moment that there is a judgment that has to be made between if this is an artwork or if this is already something that can be judged as criminal or illegal. And we'll be talking with a number of guests here today about this, and we'll try to be also very concrete, so based on examples, which we can so we can refer to, and please, the lights are also on the audience, so we have thought about a dialogue setting. You know, there will be presentations, but immediately if you have questions or comments, let's try, there is a microphone that will be passed around, so let's try to be in this dialogue mode. And I will describe very shortly the order of the blog, the program. We will start with Hans Winkler and Jakob Brauer, and they will speak. Hans is an artist who has been dealing for a long time with the issues of legal, illegal, and among others, he has been curated. He curated also a very interesting exhibition in NGBK in Berlin, Legal, Illegal, Scheißegal, and there is also a book that maybe you can have look at, which examines also the history of art through this kind of methodology of touching the illegal, and he himself, he's also legally quite well prepared to touch the illegal, I would say. And and Jakob Brauer is a lawyer specializing with art, the sphere of art. He's working for Heller & Partner in Berlin, a company that also has been advising Berlin Biennial, and it was not an easy job last year to do that. We have gone for a number of discussions. And just to mention Berlin Biennial, just to give you one example how we have tried also as curators to deal with these issues, that we have worked with Vojna Group from St. Petersburg as associate curators. And they agreed to be associate curators, but they were not supposed to give any curatorial advice, to do any research, to do any studio visits. Basically, the way to collaborate with them, associate curators, was based on an idea that they can be legitimized even more as artists. Because, of course, things like biennials or festivals can legitimize and give a judgment over somebody's practice, whether it's art or not. And Vojna is one of these groups that actually, like Pussy Riot or Famine, that is having a very clear political agenda, and they claim everything they do, it can be a riot, a demonstration, that this is art. So I was thinking, you know, if we were, for example, working with a Pussy Riot as associate curators last year, who knows, maybe we'll speak maybe about it, you know, that maybe in the trial that could have been used as an argument that they are clearly connected with an art context with the biennial, and this could maybe influence also the development of the trial, in theory at least. And so we'll have a first 45 minutes with Hans presenting intervention and disappearance in public space based on his examples and also other examples from history of contemporary art, with comments by Jakob. And then Jakob will present a little introduction to freedom of art in legal terms. So, because you know, when it comes to the trial, the judge is the person who is deciding if something is art or not. So the lawyers and the people in the legal system, they have to be trying to also follow development of contemporary art. So Jakob will tell us how the lawyers or how the legal system is re-educating or looking upon development of in art. And then we'll have also 10-15 minutes for questions and comments, and I'm sure there will be a lot of questions because the examples are really fascinating. Then we'll have a second short blog with Nikolai Klimenyuk and Dmitry Vileński. I will introduce them later, and it will be around Pussy Riot case and the Russian situation at the moment. Then we'll have an ArtLeaks presentation, and also we'll speak about ArtLeaks later. And finally, we'll have a presentation on revisiting of an action by Wochenklausur, an Austrian Vienna-based collective, actually from Steirische Herbst Festival from 1995, and with the legal issues concerning immigrants, and how we'll ask how the legislation has changed and would this action be possible today. So this is the program of the 3 hours till 1 o'clock. And now, starting with Hans, the picture you see here, it's coming from your action, from your project in 2004. As you know, in 2004, on the 1st of May, I think was the day that that Poland joined Schengen, and many, not only Poland, number of countries, joined the European Union, but also Schengen, I think, European Union, and in this moment, it was the first day that Polish-German border was open, quite significant moment, and at this moment, Hans Winkler was working on the point of the Polish-German border, on the bridge in Kostrzyn. It's a border city. And you have staged a situation called Granica, where it was an arranged car crash between a Polish car and a German car. And this car crashed with one Polish driver and one German driver, crashed in the very centimeter of a Polish-German border. And then you have created a situation that of kind of a confusion, because first of all, is this, and how shall we develop, or how should we look at this? Is it an art? Can this be a claimed art piece? Or is it just obstruction of traffic? And which side will come out of it? And also, how is it possible to judge a situation where these two legislations out of this apply and crash on this very moment of the border? So I think it's a very nice picture to start with, because we are also now at least Polish-German representation here. And Hans, please, and welcome, and give you the floor.
Thank you very much. So, yes, nice to be here. And yeah, because looking at the picture, I think before we talk about the theoretical thing, which is also work, what I'm doing, not only as an artist, also as a collector of the illegal work, of the importance of illegal work in the art history. So one thing was, out of my archive, I did this book, Legal Illegal. And just for the beginning, it's good. Let's start about the accident, which was 2004, and actually it was, I was invited by a Polish and a German curator to think about a piece right on the border, and so I hired the car and the driver, the Polish guy, and this guy didn't speak German, and the same with the German guy and the car. So both were unable to communicate, and on the day where they crashed, the car accident happened right in the middle of the bridge. Also the police showed up, the Polish and the German police, which was for me very funny. They were also unable to communicate. So the Polish people didn't speak, the Polish border police didn't speak German, and the German guys didn't speak Polish, of course. And so it was the beginning of the European Union, and I was in the middle there. And so it was, you know, an idea was developed for a while, and I, even like the photographer, I was lucky, he was a little bit insecure. This was also a theme of, therefore, he lost the camera because he was controlled by a policeman. I said, why you take a picture here of this car accident? And he was so out of, reaction, he dropped the camera. So he was too nervous. He was not a professional thief, so he was a, yeah. Anyway, but this was like a way where the accident happened, and for me as a piece, which is in a line of other pieces I did on borders, with the situation of border police authorities, where it's not only necessary to ask for permission, it's sometimes better you just do it, but it's important to, like, so I'm glad we have a lawyer here. I ask for the most projects also lawyers or advice, because law systems are different in states, in Europe, America anyway, or Russia or whatever. You cannot compare the law system. Therefore, it's good to be advised and to develop strategies. And a strategy is number one for me, for each project. So you have the idea, and then the strategy, how to do it and how to realize it without jeopardizing any inconvenience. So this is, yeah, so it was a block for, let's say, 30 minutes, right on the border, with the confusion of the policeman, and right. So, and finally, the German police guy decided to just push the car away, and so it was over. And yeah, so if you have any question or whatever, I'm open for questions in between. And otherwise, I will continue with the project. Also, is in the line of where you see it's where humor.
Maybe I have a short question.
Okay.
As well, because you say you were consulting your lawyer. What did your lawyer say?
Do it. Because it's, you know, there is not a law who say don't crash a car on the border.
Mm-hmm. That's true.
So it's not written down. So if you talk about prank, if you talk about moral issues, or about jeopardize police activities or the traffic flow, this is a different issue, but it's not a crime. It's like, whatever you call it.
As long as you don't cause a like a critical situation that would endanger life or health of anyone.
Right.
And I'm also curious, did the police or anyone ever found out that you arranged that? Or did they always think it was just a coincidence?
I think they thought it just happened, because I didn't tell them, of course. Mm-hmm. That. So they asked me what's going on, and But the next point is, I actually announced the accident a month before. It was where the show was opened. I just said something will happen soon. It was an announcement. Therefore, it's also the line in between announcement and getting publicity, or also having a kind of a contract. Yeah.
So did you have something like an audience waiting on the bridge?
No, I didn't announce the date. So it just happened. Okay, and the next project here is I realized with a former partner, PTT Red, where I found the group, the Performance Intervention Group in Berlin in 1988. And in 2000, now it was 1991, after the Desert Storm party in Disneyland. You're right, you hear that they had, the American Army had a party in Disneyland where General Schwarzkopf and Powell, they celebrated the victory of the Desert Storm in Disneyland together with Mickey Mouse. And I couldn't believe I was in America these days, and we decided we have to do something, we have to react, because it's a very crazy situation. We went to Los Angeles. I did research for 3 days where Mickey Mouse is, where he is going. You know, he's usually not all the time there, so it's 10 minutes there. He has a security system. I organized the escape, and I organized a contract. So I asked, so I look a little bit younger, right? And dressed up, and I showed him a letter where I asked him to sign it, and it say that he agreed to be punched by PTT Red into the face, and he signed it.
It was in German.
It was in German. Yeah.
So he was thinking he's signing.
He's signing something, but he saw the letter, and I didn't know that he doesn't speak German, right? So he signed it, and I slapped his face, and my PTT Red partner, we both did it. Everybody did one picture, and we took the next Greyhound bus to Tijuana, Mexico. So we had actually a very short amount of time, because security was unable to find out what's going on, because Disneyland is a very interesting space where people get programmed. You know, you have, as a worker, you must smile, and it's not allowed to be serious. And this moment of a serious action, they didn't realize, because it took them 5 minutes to realize something was not in the smile issue. So I was able to leave Disneyland without any problems and take the Greyhound bus to Mexico, like an American movie and a comic movie, and ended up in Tijuana, Mexico, without any problems. And later on, it was published in an American magazine that Mickey Mouse was punched or slapped. Yeah. Okay.
Well, it's actually quite interesting to think about this, whether there is any crime or any offense at all in this, because I mean, of course, it's something that is very unusual and that causes attraction, but at the same time, if you punch Mickey Mouse in the face, it really depends on whether you just hit his mask or the person behind it. And as long as you just hit the mask and the mask doesn't break or anything, it's actually not really a problem. So did you consult a lawyer before you did this?
Yeah, this was I asked one lawyer, and he said, it's your risk, but the most extreme thing that could happen is they kick you out of the country, but you will definitely not end up in jail. Because, as you say, it's a mask. You are hitting a figure, but it's a symbol, and maybe you have problems that Disney World is suing you. You know that if I use, for example, I wanted to document the project as a comic, and in Europe, the most comic signers or people that work on comics, they were not allowed to use the symbol of Mickey Mouse because they said they will be immediately sued by Disneyland. So they can't do that. So it was in between thing, but in the end, like I said, you have to take sometimes a risk, and if it's not a crime, and actually I have to say for me it was also a lot of fun too, you know.
You said it was published later in the newspaper, but was your, as you say in legal terms, motivation or your political motivation to do it as to comment also Mickey Mouse participation in the former ceremony? Was it clear? Was it readable? Or was it just...
Yeah. It was published in some newspaper that the reason was because of that day, especially General Schwarzkopf, used Mickey Mouse as a children toy for his propaganda, for his self-promotion, and to manipulate people, because it's for most American, Mickey Mouse is a children game. So it's, and this was a big thing where they start to discuss, and it was also last year at Taschen, they made a documentation of the project too. It's 20 years later, it's a long time, right? But in the first year, they were really quiet about statements. All right, so next is, now here it's like the borderline of Tijuana. It reminded me about the Berlin Wall. Well, you cross the border, it was allowed easily, but to go back, it's very tricky. So, and here you see right Tijuana, the border, and the wall with the viewpoint down to California, to San Diego. And this was also maybe a start for a project I'd like to show you as next. It was 2010, actually, two years ago. I worked in San Francisco, and I saw every day the day laborers, the Mexican day laborers, standing in the Mission District on the street waiting for a job to be hired for hours, a couple hours, to make some money. So most of them are illegal immigrants. So I decided a couple of years ago to do a project with the day laborers. I hired a translator who looked actually like Che Guevara. I asked them I won't hire them to do a revolution. So it's a revolution for 1 hour. I dressed them in military uniform. I gave them machetes, black flags, and they were placed in a pickup truck, and we went through Mission District direction, City Hall, San Francisco, for 1 hour. And and actually nothing happened. So no police. And after 1 hour, I stopped the intervention, and the day laborers left. I paid them before, and they left, except the machetes. I asked for the machetes. This was the only legal issue, the weapon industry. But so nothing happened. But I had a driver who knows the area, and he told me that, you know, if police is around, it might be a problem. They stop it, even for me as well as for the day laborers. But we spoke with the day laborers before about this, that it might be create a problem, but they say, don't worry, we know to handle problems. So we are running in all different directions. So it was really a cool thing. And so after this hour, yeah.
Jakob, what do you think, what Hans could be accused of in this situation?
Well, it's very difficult to tell in this case because it's it depends on, well, let's transform the thing to Germany because I don't know about the weapon law exactly and the ESA. Actually, I wouldn't be surprised if you were allowed to carry a weapon like this with you. But of course, this is an issue that I would warn you against, warn you from, if you were asking me. But the rest, it's definitely an important fact that you didn't plan a revolution, that you just actually played to plan a revolution.
How do you know?
Well, you would say so if you were sued in the end.
Yes, yes.
No, you would have to prove that.
No, of course, you have to lie and do whatever.
But the first crime, here is the fact that these day laborers are already, the hiring even for fixing a house is probably not legal because it's not illegal work, right?
They are illegal immigrants, yeah.
Okay, that's another problem.
But as you say, there are masters in surviving, and actually some of the reaction of American citizen, they came and they just asked me, what do you do if they really start a revolution? You can't do that. Because, you know, it's a thing what happened in, especially the borders in Mexico, there are all it's the truck war, and we have all the different, but then, you know, nothing happened. Especially, I think it was good, I had a very good advice from a Mexican driver. He lives, he grew up there, and he knows the people, so it was worked out, and then it was published as a revolution in different magazines in San Francisco, and it's, of course, it started the discussion, can you do it or not? Is it allowed to do it, especially as a foreigner, you come and to do something, but nothing else happened.
So, Jakob, you were saying that if Hans would be defending this as a play, you said, yes, or something that, let's imagine that this turns into a revolution, but he still defends it as a play, it was a piece of art. How far he could go in defending this if he could already have, I don't know, 5,000 people in the street?
Well, it really depends from the certain facts of the case. And I think I will touch some of these like general questions later when I will explain a bit about the about how the legal term freedom of art works. It's very complicated and it's very hard. It's always very hard to give one like answer that would be valid for every case. So maybe we postpone this a bit and talk about this later.
Yeah, and my American lawyer just said, get rid of the weapons. If police is really coming, you just say, you are an artist, you do a movie, you just forgot your permission. And but the weapons might be a problem, he said, because they're not allowed to it's a group, and they're armed, so just get rid of them. And so this was the plan, I suppose. And here is actually I worked in Istanbul and I was invited to the Focus Istanbul show, and one story, it happened that the curator, the Turkish curator and the Berlin curator, they had a kind of a fight. They stopped and 10 Turkish artists, they stopped or quit the contract, so they didn't came to the Berlin show called Berlin Istanbul. So I told the curator that I will do a piece about this issue, nothing more. So I went to Istanbul, I bought a Turkish passport in the black market for the amount I got for my fee, as well as a passport and an ID, and I traveled back to Germany and made a statement what it say. We all have different personalities, we all have different identities. I'm a Turk, okay, for a special amount of time. And I will be a Turkish artist in the art show for a while, of course. And this was part of the show where I just showed my Turkish passport and a short description that I used Turkish identity and I moved back to Germany as with different IDs, which I think would be a very good thing if everybody of us had different passports. Different personalities, like in America, it's allowed you have different passports. You can have two, three. A friend of mine had three. And in Germany, it's not allowed. It's only allowed to have one. In Turkey, it's also only one, but they are allowed to have it's tolerated to have two. And in this case, I just didn't use a different name, I used my name. I just fixed the passports with my name. The rest was the old information of another passport.
So you were a Turk with the name Hans Winkler?
Yeah, like Manager.
And so you managed to, how many borders did you cross? You traveled by train or car?
Yeah,
or
yeah.
How did you travel?
Yeah, yeah, by train.
And
sometimes I just left by not on plane.
And no one
no.
thought that
no.
this
And
was
I used
weird.
my old passport photo from 15 years ago, from my old ID card in Germany.
Let's go through some other examples from your research
All right.
with the exhibition.
Okay, and this is like one thing which I really like. It's a performance which impressed me a lot, especially if you look to Wall Street now. It's Abby Hoffman, 67. He walked with a couple friends to Wall Street, stock market, and he went to the gallery and he threw dollar bills into the stock market. To the employees, to the brokers and bankers, and everybody stopped working for a couple minutes and just grabbed the $1 bills. And he threw a couple hundred, so the market was unable or was out of control for 6 minutes, 7 minutes. And this was, I think it's a good example, especially if I think about now by Wall Street. And it's almost a forgotten piece. And for me, it was an art activist, but he also called himself as an artist.
I wouldn't be sure if it's a crime to give away dollar notes.
In
Wall Street.
Yeah, and to play with bankers.
I mean, I would tell him go do it and try. I think the risk is quite low.
Yeah, actually, in America is it allowed? It's not allowed to burn a dollar bill. But after the performance, he burned a $1 bill, and he had some problem, but he was not arrested. So it's an issue in America. All right, the next. I have two examples of this book, Legal Illegal, is one of the San Francisco artist, Terry Fox. He burned a flower field on the Berkeley University. In the same time where you remember it was hippie San Francisco, flower power, and the flower power time. And it was also the beginning of the bombing of Cambodia using different bombs and burning countries like Cambodia, Vietnam. So he started just to do, he burned it without permission, a flower field, and he said out of this issue he just started to do this performance. So, what the young people are doing these days, right? All right. And I think the last thing, which is maybe a big thing also right now, is the freedom of speech, freedom of religion, and how artists are intervening into, especially in the using the term of religion and church. And Vienna, the Situationist from Paris, 1950, say interrupted celebration at Notre Dame in Paris, which was also live on the public TV. And one of the Situationists was dressed as a monk, as a priest, a monk. He had Cappuccina, what, how you call it? I wrote down the. It was Dominican. He was dressed as a Dominican monk, and he declaimed like a pamphlet, The Death of God in Church. And a poem where he talked about is God existing or God is dead. And this ended up as a big mass confusion, so people tried to attack him and they beat him, and they all the three artists or poets were arrested. And I think this is like a
That's a very interesting issue that's, as you say, quite present nowadays, because it touches the problem of defamation of religious views, which is a crime in many legal systems. And there it's quite interesting because you see that you have something, you refer to art in order to do something, and at the same time you are kind of doing something against people that also have other very important values that that you attack with your art. So I don't know if at this point I could, or I should like start to maybe give explain a bit the background of okay, I'll wait for your slide because I will start with an example. Yes. Okay, I hope you can read it. I'm not sure, so I will read it out to you. This is the building of the Vienna Secession, and it has the engraved phrase that was quite central to the secessionist movement, der Zeit ihre Kunst, der Kunst ihre Freiheit, which translates to every age its art, to art its freedom. The secessionist movement, you probably know it, was a quasi-separatist movement of artists that in the late 19th century that objected to what they recognized as a conservative art of the prevailing art of historicism. And we should keep this situation in mind to that will help us a bit understand what freedom of art in as a legal term or legal sense means, which is what I will try to explain now. So Hans gave us some nicely illustrated examples of his interventions that are all in a gray zone, So we always have the question, are they legal or illegal? And you always ask, so what's that? How can we decide, or can we decide? And of course, the law always says it depends. And to explain what from, and maybe to even try and give some practical hints how to use this mechanism in order to benefit for your art, I would like to begin with a few words on the legal concept of freedom of art. So freedom of art is, in many Western democracies, a fundamental right. Fundamental rights are generally very important moral values that are given a predominant legal validity by embedment in a central statute or law, which is usually the constitution, written constitution. But again, not all Western democracies have written constitutions, but that's another thing. If we look at the EU, we have 27 member states, and out of these 27, 17 have a constitutional fundamental right of freedom of art. And interestingly, 16 out of these 17 have a totalitarian past, except Malta, to be precise. For example, the countries with the fundamental right are Spain, Italy, Germany, of course, and also Austria. But even where there's no fundamental right of freedom of art, like, for example, in France and in the UK, art is usually also somehow protected by the fundamental right of freedom of expression, which is also a very central and very old fundamental right that can be found in nearly every Western democracy. So then the question, where we have the right of freedom of art, is what is art? And as a German lawyer, I will refer to the legal situation in Germany now. As Hans already said, all national legal systems are generally independent of each other. But at the same time, the German situation will give a good indication of how it works elsewhere. First, when we think about legally defining art, there are two obvious difficulties. The first one is that it's pretty obvious that there's a huge difference between what constitutes a definition and what constitutes art. The definition is supposed to give very clear categories. It should be able to tell for every case precisely which facts meet the definition and which facts don't. And art, of course, is not just in our days, as you can see if you remember this phrase, is very much based on constant reformation and questioning of its borders and overcoming these borders. So that's the first difficulty. And the second one is that it's obvious that art cannot be efficiently be protected if courts would refer to the quality of a work of art in the sense of good or bad. Because if this was possible, then judges would be able to decide on their own, and the protection of the fundamental right would be very, very low, because the protection is basically against the state. And if the state somehow could just easily decide what it wants to grant this protection and what not, then there was no use of this fundamental right. So let's see at the definitions that, let's have a look at these definitions that the German courts developed that try to be as neutral as possible. The courts use a combination of three different definitions actually. it's getting a bit technical now, but we have to get through this. So, yeah. So three definitions, and out of these three, two are very vague, I would say. They call it the material and the open definition, and one, on the other hand, is very narrow, the formalistic definition. They were developed in the decades following World War II. The material definition, maybe you can just put the next picture for a moment. No. Yes. Yeah. Exactly. It has to do with this guy. Gustav Gründgens. He was a famous German actor in the mid-century, and he was very famous for his role of playing Mephisto in Goethe's Faust. And Klaus Mann, the son of Thomas Mann, wrote a novel, a fictional novel, that was again pretty clearly based on this Gründgens guy, and accused him of strong opportunism during the Nazi regime. Gründgens sued Mann, and this is where the Constitutional Court developed the material definition, because it referred to his, Klaus Mann's book, Art. And it says, art, I'm going to read this because it's a bit complicated, art is the immediate visualization of the visualizer's impressions and experiences by means of a specific formal language. So, it's very clear, isn't it? The two other definitions, the vague open one and the narrow formalistic one, were later added, and maybe you can advance one picture. They had to do with this man, Franz Josef Strauss, who interestingly kept the courts busy very often in cases on art, and he was always on the opponent's side. And ultimately he had very little success. There was a case, I'll spare you the details for the moment, but the Constitutional Court added the formalistic definition of art, which says, it's simple, as soon as something belongs to the traditional genres of art, like painting, carving, theater playing, it's probably art. And the last one, the open definition, is based on the ability of art to give room for interpretation. And it goes, art is what, by continuously interpreting it, offers further and further reaching meanings. So now we have these three definitions. And let's say we are in court. What do you do? Or better, what will the judge do? The formal definition is easy to understand. So, if your art falls into one of the classical genres, your chances are high that the court will accept that it's art. But if it doesn't, like your interventions, probably, as long as they would not be regarded as a theater, which I would doubt, the judges will, in practice, look at certain criteria. One which is just very practical, ask people who know about it, experts. So it's very good if you like to have recognized art critics write something about you, or to be present in an institution or in a gallery. Next question, what a gallery is also a bit difficult, but let's not go into the details here. Künstler Sozialkasse is something, yeah, but that's more. You have to be an artist in order to get there. So they won't take you. They will ask the same questions.
Künstlersozialkasse is a system in Germany that provides you artist health insurance. But in order to get there, you need to provide already some legal papers of artist contracts.
You have to prove that you are an artist to get there. Okay, so they will ask people who know about it. Then it's also good if you have an official art education. It's obviously not necessary to make art, but it helps. It's not so good if what you produce is either a mass product or has a very strong utilitarian aspect about it. And it's also not so good if you work on commission for someone and that someone tells you very precisely what to do. And lastly, it's very good always if what you do conveys some form of accessible meaning. So we have this, the open definition of art. And besides being regarded as art, this will also help you because your actions are will be protected by the freedom of expression at the same time. So let's say now we know that what you do is art, then what are the benefits? First you could say that freedom of art as a fundamental right is something that kind of overarches or illuminates the whole legal system. But at the same time it is not an absolute right. So like following the surrealist idea of shooting to the crowd, for example, would be a crime even if you were an artist and if it would be an artwork or you would see it as one. Sorry?
Claim it as an
art. No, if you are an artist, I mean, if you even as an artist, if you shoot people, it's a crime. Just want to make sure we're talking about the same thing.
No, because there is this famous saying of André Breton, the true surrealist act consists of going in the streets and shooting to the crowds. And this is the ultimate form of art.
So on the other hand, there are a lot of like benefits on an everyday level. We already mentioned Künstler Sozialkasse, the social security system. There are, for example, a number of tax advantages for artists. Like they don't pay business tax and they have a reduced VAT, things like that. Then the artists don't have to be members of crafts chambers, even if they manufacture things. So there are less rules that people can put, or there are actually no rules that people can put on the quality of what they produce. There are things like street law. If you sell your own artworks in the street, you don't need a permission, unlike other people that sell things on the street. If we look at criminal law, there are some explicit exemptions, like what is allowed as soon as it's art, for example, using Nazi symbols and distribution of propaganda material for anti-constitutional organizations. This is usually a crime, but in art it's allowed. The statute explicitly says that. So what in all the other cases where art doesn't show up in the criminal statute? So freedom of art will help you, the less defined criminal provision or an administrative fine is. For example, in the earlier years after the war, the authorities often tried to forbid actions that they found were against the public policy. And it's now very clear and undisputed that this is not possible, that freedom of art is a fundamental right and it cannot be, art cannot be forbidden based on public policy issues. Also, for example, there's a provision of forcing someone by threat. In German it's Nötigung. I was thinking about this in your car accident intervention. You could at least say that by having a car intervention you force the people that want to cross the border to remain where they are. So that would actually be a criminal act. But at the same time, if you say this is art, and if you have a good reason for it, then it would not be a criminal act.
But what does mean good reason?
That's like the criteria that I was telling before. It's always good if you can explain it. I know that this is difficult sometimes with art, but the judge will hardly accept something which does not show any any sense in any way. It's a complicated thing, but maybe it's an interesting fact, and I think, I mean, I would say that it's something that it's a moment where art and law are actually unable to meet each other, because the legal system cannot offer anyone to like do things that are not somehow foreseeable, that cannot be predicted or anything like that. So and actually it's good that it is like this. If the law would say artists are allowed to shoot other people, it would be a terrible world to live in, except for the artist maybe. So I think there's always a point where an artist has to see where he also cannot really demand that all his actions are legal. I think at some point the artist has to just accept that what he wants to do is illegal, and then he has to think, do I still want to do it? And I mean, that's also an interesting fact, interesting issue in the whole Pussy Riot affair, but I think we will mention that later. But there was a question, I think.
I have a question, because when I was working in a real Stadttheater in the beginning of my career, there was a saying that if an actor commits any crime, let's say half an hour after the show, he would be excused, pardoned. So that was, at least, I don't know if that was a rumor or if that's, because there's apparently is some exception for people performing, so that something continues in there. This is the one question. How would you comment on that? Is that a rumor? The other thing is, how would you comment that crazy story of Bayreuth this year, where the singer, I think it was a Russian singer, had this Nazi tattoo. And of course, people like Christoph Schlingensief or Jonathan Mese would have included that, of course, and putting it as an artistic act also. But he was, let's say, dismissed, and he could not perform there. So what is this kind of tattoos, the emblem, which is seen then in a certain moment? So what is the tattoo of swastika?
Thank you. I think I'll start with the first question. It is a rumor, if you would take it like as an absolute thing. But there is, if you want to sentence anyone for a criminal act, one element that's always necessary is that he does it voluntarily, or that he knows that the criminal person knows what he's doing. So I could imagine that courts would, or she, that criminal, that courts would find an actor to be still that much in his role that some things are kind of that he does them without controlling himself. But it definitely has borders, and maybe that would apply to driving too fast on the street, but certainly, for example, not to hurting or killing anyone. The second question, as to Bayreuth, this is surely not really a legal problem in the way that it is forbidden to have had a Nazi symbol as a Ukrainian, I think he was a Ukrainian, wasn't he? Or was he Russian?
Russian
singer, okay. But that, I mean, that was basically an issue that Bayreuth had with its reputation and with its own past, of course. And as far as I know, they kind of agreed to end the collaboration. And I guess that the singer was paid anyway, and he just left, and they thought it would be better for everyone. So that's not something where anyone referred to a law, it was just a pure contract, you could say. But it has an interesting aspect. I don't know if you heard about it, that Jonathan Mese is going to do the Parsifal in 2016. So I think we will get back to the issue of Nazi symbols then. He is he's directing and doing the stage design for Parsifal in 2016 in Bayreuth.
Jonathan
Mese is a I think Hamburg Berlin-based artist that pretty often uses symbols of Nazi symbols and who also deals a lot with this whole Wagner Bayreuth aesthetics. So
calls it dictatorship of art.
Yeah, exactly. So I don't know. We are probably.
Do you want still to continue with some points, or shall we open and take questions? Is it something you wanted to close up your presentation with?
I have maybe like 2 points that I would like to just mention,
yes.
And I can do this very briefly, but I think it's important to know that like all over law, there's this general rule of commensurability, which means that the judge will, in the end, always balance the different involved rights against each other. And if you, especially if you have acts that violate other people's rights, not only the state, then the judge will never give you a free ride as an artist, a general one. So this is very important in all these religious cases that involve religious defamation of religious views. And the second point is that I want to make clear that even where you have a statute written freedom of art, fundamental right, it is no guarantee that you are better off as an artist. We were talking about Europe, but another state that has a constitutional fundamental right of freedom of art is Russia. And so in the end, it really depends on the whole legal system, which can have strong influences by the general political views, kind of by the way the system works. So what I was telling before would probably apply to the European democracies. It would maybe apply to the US, but apparently it doesn't completely for Russia.
We'll ask you later also to comment on Pussy Riot when we have Dimitri and Nikolai speaking. But Jonas, you wanted to ask a question.
I have a question. Article 20.4 of the German Constitution of the right to of any German citizen, the right to rebel against the government if no other measures are possible. And especially if the no other measures are possible, I have a question. As an artist, you are working within your capabilities. So how does that apply to if you rebel against unconstitutional actions in your perception and your only measure you have is actually art? Is that then already a ground enough for your action?
Do I understand it right that if you act against the Constitution? Is that your question?
Well, no. Article 20.4 of the German Constitution says that if the Constitution is under threat, all German citizens have the right to oppose any person who is endangering the German Constitution.
Okay.
And
it's the defense of the Constitution.
Defense of the Constitution.
Yeah.
But if these laws are actually not made by the legislative branch, but by the executive branch, which is often the case, during not abstention, emergency law or state of exception situations, and these rights are actually not made by the juridical branch and by the legislative branch, and then as artists you rebel against that, then your only measure you have as an artist is art, right?
I mean, if the only measure is art, art is something that you can refer to. So that's the important thing about it. That's what the freedom of art. That's its effect, I would say. I mean, there are several fundamental rights, like family, for example, and school, interestingly, is the school system as well. And so if you say, I would want to defend the family, then this would allow you to a certain degree also to attack things that, or actions that the state does. But at the same time, there is this border in the constitution of changing the constitution. Of course, you could start a revolution based on art, but this would not be legal. But revolutions are never legal. That's with the thing. That's what makes it a revolution. There is a provision that says if the system, German system, the political system is ever to be changed, there must be a new constitution and people must vote on it. But of course, in order to get there, it's hardly possible to imagine a situation where there is nothing like a revolution with illegal acts before this happens.
No, I also think for talking about this issue about art, reaction, what's legal or illegal, I think the point of is it art or not should be number two. At first, I think it's always the idea, because it's too easy for me if somebody say, you know, I can do what I want because it's art. And I see it sometimes, I was teaching in an art school and everything is in the end art, and it's not, it is not. You cannot declare yourself as an art, so there's a lot of shit around. And I think it's in the end what counts is about maybe as an artist your way of living or in the end of your history, but it's not only art. And I think sometimes it's too easy just to say it's art, therefore it's good. And I think you have to, if you do something, you have to take the risk and you have to stand for it. Doesn't matter if you art or not. Otherwise it's how you call it, it's feige. You know, just excuse me, it's art. Yeah, and I think this is a wrong thing.
I mean, the system. Okay, there. Let's hear these questions maybe first.
Sorry, it's not a question, just a comment. And it was not in charge, but a lawyer helped me once when I had talked with authorities, or they didn't want me to do something, and he said, if people insist very strongly and even aggressive that it's not art, you can be sure that it is art. I like this explanation somehow.
Yeah, actually, Wojna was also saying that only in the moment, rather addressing art people, that only in the moment that you are not sure if something is art or not, this is the moment when art happens, because this is the moment of challenge and somehow redefinition.
I have a more practical question. In Germany, as a country that, by the definition of female, I guess we're a democracy because you can run around with bare breasts and nobody takes you to the police for that. How many court cases related to art do we actually have? And I mean, it's really a question of interest. And are there any interesting cases, or is it all about, in the end, copyright? I mean, is it more you take my Mickey Mouse, you're not allowed to do that because I have the rights to it? Or did we have in the past 10 years really interesting cases about the definition of art and what can artists do or not?
I mean, there are definitely a number of cases that are not, that don't have anything to do with copyright. Two of them I already presented that are from the first case, the Mephisto case from the 70s, and the Strauss decision. Anachronistischer Zug was with a group of theater, street theater players who made a theater play that also put Franz Josef Strauss kind of close to Nazi ideas. And this is where the courts start to balance the right of freedom of art that the theater plays can refer to with the freedom of the right of honor and of dignity of Franz Josef Strauss, in a way. And so these cases are not, well, they don't happen very often, but there are, I think the last big one was about 5 or 6 years ago, about a book that Maxim Biller wrote with the title Esra. It was about a story about a very, I think, a woman with a quite liberal sexual life that was clearly identifiable as, I think, his ex-girlfriend, that was also a well-known actor, a Turkish ex-girlfriend. And so that's these cases where you often have situations where you have two citizens involved, and one is suing the other, or wants the other to stop something, and the other one refers to art. You don't have very often that you have an action against the state because the state forbids you to do something. Sometimes, of course, the state would do that, and I think in the Strauss case, it started with the artists, the theater players, being accused of defamation by the state, and they were sentenced probably a fine of maybe a couple of hundred D-mark, something like that. But that's where it comes from. But you don't really have things like in Russia now, for example, or I wouldn't know about anything like that in Germany in the last decades.
But you are working in the company dealing with art and artists. In your practice, did you have, what was the most interesting case, or which kind of cases do you deal with, if you at large?
Well, in the end, of course, a lot of cases deal with these practical questions. Maybe it could be something like Hans, or like you mentioned the Biennale earlier, that of course you want to like have an opinion on the effects, on the legal effects of what you plan to do, and the lawyer will tell you something, and you, in the end, you will either do it or not. But you know maybe a bit better what would expect you if it goes wrong. I mean, a lot of our work is also contracts, because in the end, artists do, if they, especially artists who have who do installations or like big sculptures, they always need people to fabricate that, and so there are a lot of legal issues involved with that, especially if it is an international thing. And so this is the questions that we deal more with, the, so to say, everyday business of artists than the defense of their fundamental rights.
I have some questions. Hans Winkler, I wanted to ask you about this revolution piece. The first question would be, why did you hire only 10 workers and not many more? Because then would your action be much more visible? Was it because of some financial reasons, or did you have other reasons? And the other two questions are more connected with ethical issues. Of course, there are actions which are legal, but there are also some ethical rules which may be violated. And especially when artists work with other people who are not artists themselves, a bunch of ethical questions arises. And the question would be, what was the reaction of these people, these workers? Was it anyhow important for them that they are taking part in your project? Do you maybe stay in touch with them? And the third question would be, I'm not sure if I understood what was your real aim, or did you really aim at a change in the status of these people? Because what you actually did, you reinforced the mechanisms that are at play there. They are used as a cheap source of labor. Yeah? And in your project, you also somehow used them. Maybe not, it's not the best word, but it's a bit controversial for me. Yeah. Three questions.
Too many questions. Okay. Now, the first was about the numbers.
It was just, you know, I had not enough space in the on the car, so we had to choose 10. Actually, there were way more, they wanted to participate. And because I work in San Francisco now for 12 years, I'm teaching intervention, public art in the Art Institute in San Francisco, so I know the area, so I know the people. So I know a lot of Mexican people. I'm every year almost in Mexico. I know the issue, what's going on, you know? It's a long story. And, you know, people have always different opinions, and it's always a big, you know, the PC say, don't do that, don't do that. But like in art, if I say, okay, it's a point where after all the research I did, all this experience, you have to do this, you know? Okay, the next slide. So, for me, it's, you know, you see the day laborers every day in front of your house, where actually I live there, and so it's part. I talked to them, I translated, and it was a discussion for a long time. So it was good. So nobody was forced, and yeah. And this is like, you know, the Mexican, they call California as Mexico. You know, because there's the country was stolen, so they still think that it's their own, so it's an issue. So many, many issues. And therefore it's always hard to talk about ethical things, because everything is, I think, way more complicated. And reality is way more complicated than art. And therefore you just go in, you sneak in, and you take a cut, and then you realize something. And also reaction is part of the piece too.
Actually, time is running. It has been really fascinating. And what I suggest is maybe that we... thank you very much, Hans, and thank you very much, Jakob. But so...
You're kicked out. You're kicked out. So...
And let's, if you don't mind, maybe you could move there and also continue to comment on our other guest and the Russian session referring to Russia.
Right.
And please... Dimitri and Nikolai, please come on the stage.
Right.
So we have like 1 minute technical.
All right. Thank you. Maybe to
German team, we have a Russian team, and I would like to introduce next speakers of the discussion. Nikolai Klimenyuk, who is a political editor, a political commentator, and editor of an online magazine in Russia, Public Post, but also you're of Ukrainian origin, you are a
citizen,
a German citizen,
yes.
Also, yes. And right now back in Russia. And you have been following Pussy Riot's trial.
Exactly.
And actually we have, I mean, we have been all following, I guess, this Pussy Riot trial, but very much also from Western perspective and through Spiegel and the other materials, and not so much maybe from Russian perspective. That's why it would be also great to hear from both of you more insight and precise and less maybe romanticized comment about this. And Dmitry Bilański from Что делать, an artist, political thinker, commentator, writer, philosopher, will speak actually about statement, which was read and speak about the statement which was written by an art community in the support of Pussy Riot trial by Rodchenko School in Moscow, and you will refer to it and comment it, and also say how art actually has been treated in this trial as a fundamental freedom. So, as we were saying, this so-called art aspect. So we'll start with Nikolai and your comment, maybe your picture and landscape of how Russia looked under this trial for 15-20 minutes.
Yeah. Hello, everybody. I would like to attach actually to the discussion or whatever to Jakob and Hans's presentation. As we are talking about art and crime here, it would be absolutely unfair not to mention Alexander Brenner, a key figure of Russian actionist movement in the 90s. It was about 1990-something, 1998 or 1999. Alexander Brenner went to the Stedelijk Museum in Amsterdam and painted a dollar sign on a white-on-white composition by Kazimir Malevich, which was immediately punished as an act of vandalism, and Brenner went to jail for about 2 years. And he was sentenced to about 2 years, and he was released on probation, which is a usual practice in democratic countries. And I was there with Brenner when he was preparing for this action, and as a witness, I know that he was perfectly aware of the fact that he is committing a crime, and that he's going to be punished, and that he's going to jail, which is absolutely not the case with Pussy Riot. Because if we apply the notions of art and crime to this particular case, and we see art is on the other, so-called art, is on the other side, and crime is on the other side. From the criminal, from the legal point of view, what Pussy Riot did was a minor offense, which is fined by 25 euros, according to Russian law. It's called, offending religious beliefs or something like that, and you have to intervene with a church service to be actually punished for this. Now let me say a couple of words to the background of the action. Well, there was there are actually two parts of the Pussy Riot performance. One is the video clip, which was released on the 22nd of February, and this video clip, this is the piece many of you have probably seen, has this video clip was recorded on two locations. One of them was Christ the Savior Cathedral, where they went to on the 20th or 21st of February, and the other part was filmed in some other cathedral about a week before. Yeah. Epiphany Cathedral in Yelochovo, exactly. So, when the video was released, nothing happened. Well, people frowned. Well, everybody I knew was sort of surprised. What was that? What a stupid thing. And when I say everybody I knew, I mean friends, my friends and friends of my friends, and probably their friends was the entire audience of this video clip. So there was no impact, no reaction, nothing happened for a couple of days. And then something happened. Actually, the list of Pussy Riot members, and this group is performs well, nobody knows exactly who are the members of the group. They perform anonymously. A list of their names was published in blogs in some right-wing community, and the list was wrong. So it was obvious that the police was involved in the case because, well, it was the Christ the Savior performance was the fifth or the sixth performance by Pussy Riot, and they were not they were arrested only once during their whole career. After they performed on the Red Square, it was in January. And this is the only list of performance that existed to, up to that moment. So the list of performers who participated on in the action on the Red Square appeared in right-wing blogs, and it was and it became somehow obvious that the police is after them, because the only leak of this information could be a police protocol taken after after the action. Then, and as far as I know, there were two girls mentioned on the list which were not even close to Christ the Savior Cathedral, and at least one of them was a strong opponent to this action because she is a devout Orthodox believer. Believe me or not, there are devout Orthodox believers among Pussy Riot members. What happened after that has nothing to do with law and legal persecution. It was you know, like a song what Jakob said, the judge will consider this, the judge will consider that, the judge will think how to if this law applies to that situation, which was absolutely not the case in this funny trial, which was a part of a piece of art by itself. It was so so Kafkaesquely absurd, and well, what happened in the Christ the Savior Cathedral? There were five performers and a group of assistants. The performers were came into the cathedral, went to the altar, to the sanctuary, and started to. They didn't have any musical instruments. They put on their balaclavas. They started to sing, to sing and to dance, and they shouted, "Holy Mother of God, cast Putin away!" And it lasted for 40 seconds. Then they were cast away themselves by the cathedral security, and then nothing happened. So they went home. In the trial, there were two absolutely unconnected streams of information. The first stream was produced by the court itself. And the main statement of the court was, oh, there was nothing political there. They mentioned a certain presidential candidate. This is what how they put it, a certain presidential candidate, just to distract the court's attention from their intention to offend the feelings of Orthodox believers and to ignite religious hatred. And the other stream of information was produced by the defendants. So the first, and this stream is clearly divided in two parts. The first part was purely visual. So they provided the world with iconic images of pretty, very beautiful women sitting in that, well, it was not a cage, it was a glass aquarium. And this aquarium has a very funny background because it was specially designed for Khodorkovsky. Normally, defendants in Russian courts sit in cages. And cages provide stronger images, but they are better for defendants because of the air circulation. So the Khodorkovsky defense and Lebedev defense went to the European Court for Human Rights and against the cage. And the decision of the European Court was that the cage is a clear violation of defendants' rights, and that's why the cage was replaced with this glass aquarium, which provides no air circulation at all. And it was the trial was in the summer, so the three women in this glass box nearly suffocated, because there was no air. The other thing is that there is an opening on the belly level, so you have to stay like that to address the court, because otherwise nobody hears you. So the first part of the trial was the visual one. So they provided images, and the most famous image is Nadezhda Talakonikova, the beauty of the three, leaning through this opening towards the Reuters photographer. You know the picture from the Spiegel cover. The next part was the trial itself, where the defendants had the possibility to speak, and the constellation changed a bit because the real star of the second part was Maria Alekhina, the blonde one. If you know the faces. Why? Well, okay. How shall I describe a blonde woman in a not sexist manner? The one with the fair hair? The student of Rodchenko Academy, exactly. The first part was dominated by the student of philosophy who provided nice images, and the second part was dominated by a student of visual arts who provided sense. and philosophy. I have to somehow I have to come to the conclusion of this spontaneous presentation, and it goes like this. From the very beginning of the whole story, from the moment the clip appeared, and until now, there are several discussions around the group going on in Russia. The first one is if they should be if they should be just auskepeitscht, could anybody help me? Whipped? If they should be whipped, or if they should go to jail for their performance. So the liberal part of the society tends mostly to the whipped version. The more conservative part of the society thinks the jail is quite fair. The other discussion, if it is the more liberate one, is if it is art or not, and the artistic sort of mainstream, and I'm speaking about contemporary art circles, because conservative and academic and other sort of artistic circles are the whipped and jailed fraction, and we are not referring to their position. So the mainstream of the contemporary art reception is that it is bad art, bad texts, and the whole international glory is fucking undeserved. And this is the reception. But the liberal part is surely absolutely convinced that they shouldn't sit in jail. Even bad art is not a reason. I'm not sure. Probably some people think that bad art is the best reason for going to jail. I think it's bad art is artistic standard somehow. And to round up my whole presentation, if you are an artist, please come to Russia. It's an ideal place for artists now, because it's rebel's paradise. When Mahler performed his first symphony for the first time, 1889, it was a major scandal. It was on the cover pages of many European papers, and it was considered a crime against art, against religion, against sacred order of things. And you had to be Mahler, and you had to write a revolutionary symphony to provoke such an effect. I don't know what you had to. In the 60s, in the 70s, it was still possible to provoke general attention. Think of Austrian actionism, but I'm not sure they managed to cover pages of any major national or international magazine. Was Nietzsche ever on the cover of the Spiegel? Yeah, but Well, it was strong, but it was a really, you know, heroic effort. And now you don't have to do anything. You just come up and say, oh, I don't like the church or anything. I don't like Putin and thank you very much.
Thank you, Nikolai and Dimitri. I'm sure you have many things to comment on it. I just have one comment that maybe it's a paradise for you to be a rebel artist, but if there is no a serious discussion after if your art has a political consequence or it can be judged as art or not,
you can go to Austria and discuss the artistic.
This is what we are doing right now.
The artistic part.
Yeah. So, Dimitri, please let's continue.
I feel a bit uneasy because when in last minute it was that kind of invitation, that improvised discussion and presentation of Pussy Riot, and always who I am here to speak. I definitely not expert on Pussy Riot. And
we are not only among experts, you know.
Yeah, I'm also not somehow person who closely affiliated to them. I knew some of them not so well, but anyway. And actually, at the same time, I think it's very important situation to discuss, and it's really, I'm very proud that actually these three girls managed to create that situation somehow, consciously or unconsciously. It's another thing. We can discuss the whole situation around discourse of tactical media. It belongs to the world. So I'm here as a part of Russian community who very much was involved with different political and social and different form of activities in Russia last decade, and also very important that also it's kind of generation issue. So it's the girls, it's like my daughters, you know. What can I say? You know, I'm always proud of your daughters, whatever they do. Anyway, so I would like to be as modest as possible. And yesterday, when I was preparing to read this open letter, can you project it? It's a bit another text, so I think. So I started, because my English is far from perfect and I was a bit training, I discovered this letter have amazing poetic quality of kind of declaration. So I little bit play around and transform into kind of visual poetry. Really improvised in the plane. So, but at the same time, let's read it together and try to sing. And also, I think it's very important statement. I think international discussion is very important, but what followed this action and position of particular Pussy Riot inside of Russian political and cultural movement actually was very rewarding in relation to local inner situation. And the way how it discussed really make me feel not so depressed in Russia anymore. So, open letter was initiated by faculty of the Rodchenko School and Photography in Moscow and other members of the Russian art community. If you could help me with the scrolling, because I will read on my computer, but you just follow, but it doesn't have to be synchronized, doesn't matter. We, faculty of the Rodchenko School of Photography and Multimedia and other members of Russian art community are extremely alarmed by the trial of three young women accused of hooliganism as a result of their performance in the Cathedral of Christ the Savior. I make some cuts of what they written in small letters. We write this letter to express our complete solidarity with them and also to elaborate on few points belonging to our field of professional competence. The accusations against Pussy Riot are false and hypocritical. They are based on sacrilege or blasphemy, a term that doesn't exist in current criminal law, the disguised form of political repression. Nobody would have prosecuted this woman had they asked the Virgin Mary to defend Putin, even in non-traditional manner. The trial against Pussy Riot is a trial against dissidents, and the way the defendants have been treated and detained has been unreasonably severe. As citizens, we are outraged by the repressive trial, and like many other people in our country and around the world, we demand an end to this shameful mockery of justice and the full vindication and release of Pussy Riot. Actually, the letter was released during the trial, about a week before the end, when things was not clear. So, but I think it has relevance in regards to the topic we discussed today. People involved in contemporary art in Russia have particular reason to be outraged and alarmed. During the trial, the phrase contemporary art was always, when uttered by prosecution, accompanied by the mocked addendum, so-called. Its very right to exist was thus questioned. It was implied that contemporary art is a space of hooliganism, which, to make matter worse, it supported from abroad. We therefore deem it necessary to speak out on this issue. Contemporary art, by its very nature, is a public statement about the present day. The themes and forms may vary, but if the present day is such as it happens in Russia today, a present day characterized by lawlessness, lack of political choice, criminal oppression of citizens by authorities, the absence of impartial courts, obscurantism and fundamentalism, then artist has no choice but to stop worrying about formal nuances and become a political artist. It would be impossible and immoral to draw boundaries here, and we refuse to accept the other notion of art, safer for authorities that are being imposed on us. Art is always an act, a deed. To be heard in contemporary Russia, the artist is forced to engage in extreme acts. This has been proven by huge impact that Pussy Riot action has had. However, we support Pussy Riot not because we think they are entitled to special rights with respect to other citizens. For instance, the right of provocation. Mindless provocation have never been the goal of the real artist. As artists, Pussy Riot have no special rights, but they do have a special duty, the duty to represent a society whose political will is shackled, a society deprived of freedom and justice, a society with a poor understanding of human rights, a society whose mouth is politically gaggled and whose eyes are blinded by mendacious TV channels. Pussy Riot upheld this duty in full. Thanks to their deeds and the authorities' reaction to it, there are now people in all parts of the country who have begun to understand what is happening to them. As experts, many of us are constantly asked how we assess the quality of Pussy Riot's performance. Some of us thought from the very outset that it was outstanding, while other of us have changed their opinion over time. The quality of an artwork is not contained in the work itself. It's reflected rather in its power, its impact, in commentaries by the artists who made it, and to a great extent in a public reaction to it. Pussy Riot's action is an incredibly powerful work of protest art and activist art. It's revealed such profound ills in our society that its impact will continue to be felt for a long time to come. It's only thanks to Pussy Riot that we have begun to discuss things that have not been open to debate for many years. During the months of their detention, and the authorities and the Russian Orthodox Church become more and more relentless. Pussy Riot's action acquired more and more value, and they themselves grew in our eyes tremendously. Through the trial, the public statements and comments were clear, philosophically profound, and morally impeccable. We are proud of them. Those speeches will undoubtedly, like the action of the Cathedral Christ of the Savior, find their place in the history of Russian social life. We also need to stress that our support for Pussy Riot doesn't imply any anti-clerical stance. The same is true for the unfairly accused artist. The stance taken by the Russian Orthodox Church in the case contradicts the feeling, thoughts, interest, and faith of many ordinary believers whose eyes have opened by Pussy Riot case to the real state of affairs in the country and the church. Splitting society and the art world into believers and non-believers benefits only the authorities and the court leadership of the Russian Orthodox Church. Pussy Riot spoke on behalf of everyone, and we support them in this. Contemporary art is not art only for non-believers, or only for the educated, only for the rich. It's for those who are concerned about what's happening in the present. Contemporary art should be consciousness of society, and that consciousness can tell society unpleasant or painful things, sometimes in a way that is irritating and uncomfortable. It's not separated from the common people. It's first to feel pain, express it, and thus attempt to heal it. We are glad that Pussy Riot, as we have come to know them during the trial, have finally shown us the image of what the artist in Russia should be. Not a senseless provocateur or prankster, but a rather citizen, a hero. Then it's big passage about nominations them to Kandinsky Prize, which actually play out right now, these few days before I arrived. It's actually a big case because people start to withdraw them from a long list of the prize, which somehow arise again chances for them enter the long list, but it's a long story. So we demand that the court completely vindicate Maria Alyukhina, Ekaterina Samuskevich, and Nadezhda Tlakovnikova. So this was the letter. Nikolai, me, and many people signed it, and we stayed.
One remark. The contemporary art was not the only topic denounced in during this trial as suspicious, so-called, and semi-criminal. The other topic was feminism, which was openly brandmarked as un-Christian and anti-social.
We have a couple of minutes also for your questions or comments to what have been said. Maybe you also have a comment, Jakob and Hans, and then no. So please, there, we have three, four minutes for comments.
Maybe can I say something? Because actually, it was a very good question at the end, very much related to that kind of state of emergency, which actually real, I mean, true art always kind of constitutes. That actually they really reach this kind of gray zone of illegality when that institutional order have a chance to be transformed, violently or non-violently, we don't know. But this particular, that moment of suspension, where we don't know. Because what is the law? Law is always a violence. Look at the history. I mean, it's legitimized violence. So people answer also with certain form of violence. And I think it's really very crucial debate on what kind of things, what kind of violence today, because actually maybe it brings us to very, for me, ungrounded debate on that kind of non-violent character of new protest movement. Why? It was always about violence. And as long as we, I mean, I'm not speaking about somehow direct, it's kind of symbolic violence that must be part of that any type of action if you really would like to change something. So you can't negate and say, oh, we are non-violent. What the fuck is that? You can't be non-violent to change something. That's completely stupid.
Even there's the whole debate about non-violent strategies. I think Popovich said that.
Yeah. I mean,
but
yeah.
Part, non-violent strategies are also part of violent.
No, it's radical non-violence and.
The present situation in Russia makes this discussion somehow redundant. Well, you can't obey the law and be not violent because, well, there is no law and you are always confronted with violence.
But
you know, one thing is
now it's, you know, I saw actually, while, you know, it's a wide field, violence, but also humor is important. I was really impressed. I saw on German TV a reaction, you know, where people in Moscow, they use the blue boxes, they put them on cars, they played police.
It's a Boyna action.
Yeah.
It was not a Boyna action. It's a civic movement initiated by a prominent journalist.
Okay.
But I mean, just one comment on violence and Pussy Riot. Actually, what I found interesting in how they turned this trial against it was at one point, at least seen from abroad, a trial about Russia, contemporary Russia, and not so much about them. So they have really used this situation and. I think that like having a little bit known the practice of Voina that they were before, but now they separated from. I think that in Voina's case, very often I can see, you know, Putinesque-like way of doing things. They play very much with violence, they with authority, with the power. And Pussy Riot sneaked out of it, at least in the way of how the trial was managed by them. And I think this is also some kind of a paradigm shift, I would say, in the protest movements in last years in Russia.
Well, you know, if it was intended or, but it happened that their performance in the Christ, the Savior Cathedral, and the clip was a perfect piece of political and social protest, and it became obvious. Well, not. From the very beginning, because the initial reaction was sort of normal. They perform something which does not belong to the space of a church. They were escorted to the street, and that was about it. And if there is no counter reaction, then there is no there is no point in protesting, and then it was just stupid. And so it was, this is what many people thought in the first days. What was that? Nobody reacts, looks absurd. And then when the whole thing happened, it became obvious that they somehow unearthed something really big, and showed the real state of affairs in or provoked the real state of affairs in many spheres to manifest itself.
Dimitri,
just very short,
yes,
because
course.
Actually, first of all, I think that we really in a danger of kind of reducing all spectrum of modalities which developed in Russian protest culture either to Voina or to Pussy Riot. And I'm very bit skeptical about it. First of all, it's much more rich, but what Voina and Pussy Riot so demonstrate is amazing ability in operating with tactical media. In particular current concrete historical situation in Russia. Then I don't want to go too far because actually it was a question to you guys because right now, because your particular that kind of legal approach, very based on that kind of very traditional concept of autonomy of art, where certain Freiheit, so certain freedom could be expressed and defended. But right now, when we have no boundaries between art and real life, and what is most dangerous between art and media? Because media has its own logic. So I can, in 5 minutes, explain why Pussy Riot or Voina became so popular. But its logic has nothing to do with the mechanism of contemporary art of academia. It's another dimension of economy of attention, which only can be connected to mass culture. And then it brings us into a big debate how that separations from Greenberg and Adorno between mass culture and art was formulated before, and if we able and need to formulate it now, on which terms. And then bring us again, okay, what is art? It's life. And actually, Pussy Riot never advocates themselves as an artist. They never position. Actually, quite different to Voynich. Voynich apparently insists that we are out to start.
This will be a long discussion, a great trailer, because we have 5 hours for this discussion on Wednesday, so that's a marathon. Because I think if we go into this now,
it's fascinating.
We really have a lot, big block on this, and we will have a lot of discussion on this, but we use it as a trailer to be up till Wednesday for this discussion.
Yes. Okay. Thank you so much, Dimitri and Nikolai, and sorry that we have to keep track of the time. Please stay here, and sorry, we have to...
It's just, like, it's not a question, is that available? Well, it is a question.
A comment?
Is it available online? Because there's loads of...
Oh, yes, it is. Available online.
Declaration. Yeah. You can follow it. It was actually published in Russian. We translated it into English. It's on our blog, but I think it was spread quite well. And art leaks and many sources. Yes.
But you can have one content
and
put it there, the
blog
with material
or the regular lecture. Yeah. Mike. Okay. So, no, please stay and just move a little bit around the table. And we continue with art leaks, so just 1 minute technical change here, and then with Wochenklausur, so two more preparations. Like to introduce Corina Apostol from ArtLeaks, who will introduce the platform ArtLeaks and other members of the group. And please, let's move on.
Thank you very much, and thank you for the invitation. There's a lot of us, so we'll try to be very brief with our comments. So my name is Corina Apostol. I'm an art historian and curator. And these are my colleagues with whom we began the platform ArtLeaks. To my right is Vlad Morariu, who is a PhD student and art critic working in the UK. Valentina Desideri, who is a performer and artist. Vladan Jeremic from Belgrade, who is an artist and political activist in Belgrade. And Dima Vilenski, who you know. So I'm going to introduce the platform briefly, and then there will be comments from all the members. Okay, so ArtLeaks emerged as a collective reaction against the problems which all of us working as artists, curators, critics, etc., encountered in the workplace. Some of these problems are non-payment of fees for artists, wage delays, or even working without a contract, without benefits, which are more and more becoming the status quo in the art world. As legislations and practices regarding these artist rights generally vary very much from country to country, and we are living in the more and more precarious situations, usually cultural managers and institutions are not able to afford a fee for artists. They are not able or even to keep their promises. And usually when one demands to be compensated, there is a long silence, and this situation can go in many directions. And we, in ArtLeaks, we try to find solutions in these situations and to sort of expose these cases publicly. We don't believe that there is one paradigm that would work for everybody, but we do believe that if we don't raise these problems as part of a larger system on inequality and exploitations, that these things will not change, but they will make abuses more normal and deepen conditions that deprofessionalize and depoliticize our cultural workers' social mission. So leaking cases constitute for us a very important opportunity. We consider it a political gesture to speak about problems, our problems in a public space, and to have the space to occupy a virtual space where this is all debated. We also, in Artleaks, deal with problems concerning abusive cultural managers and those who abet these abuses, restrictive institutional spaces, and instances of isolation, blacklisting, being obstructed, or even being fired for raising one's voice against injustice, and in some cases, even worse, being fined or being put in jail. We are very concerned about the suspension of critical discourse as a result of all these dynamics under the pretext sometimes of other existing so-called emergencies, such as the lack of funds, the disappearing of exhibition spaces, the gentrification and the shrinking of public space in general. So we publish these cases online and initiate discussions around them so that everybody is aware of these histories. Everybody should know what they are entering into when you are in a working relationship with certain people and certain spaces, and also what one encourages if you stay passive and don't raise your voice about it. And in the end, we don't try not to act as sort of police or try to punish the guilty and in general, but we are mostly about identifying these bad practices. And usually in Artleaks, when we have a case, we don't present just one side of the issue, but multiple versions of a conflict. And everybody that anybody that does not agree or wishes to comment can do so freely on the website. And so by creating this space and shedding light on the situations, we believe that solutions, real solutions, can be formulated. Otherwise, conflicts risk to be neutralized as gossip and or internal drama, and they do not fail to create tensions which we believe are necessary. Leaking and art leaking, we believe, escapes somehow the logic of a contract, a working contract of marketing or of reports. That's why for us they're very important, sort of a subversive gesture and a necessary gesture. And demanding more equitable and better conditions for our work, in demanding an end to repression, we want to also raise consciousness about exploitation, but also self-exploitation in an international context, and formulating together more just conditions as political demands. I also want to end by saying that we strongly believe that there has to be solidarity among cultural workers, and our goal should be focused on finding narratives about these common problems. And we hope that Artleaks can contribute to finding these narratives, we'll continue to work alongside already existing groups from New York to Moscow, to Ljubljana, to Belgrade, to Bucharest, to all these organizations and related struggles which now are emerging more and more as a powerful voice for cultural workers' rights. So that's my contribution, and now Dimitri will talk about one of our initiatives. because in addition to art leaking, we also have other actions that we do, and one of these is the No Fee Statement, which was initiated by two collectives in Bucharest, the Bureau of Melodramatic Research and Paradis Garage, who are not unfortunately with us. Dimitri, you want to say something about this?
Why should I?
because you're...
I can also speak only from a very perspective, personal
position when using these protocols, because actually, we know more than often the institution sometimes very uneasy, or at least sometimes have a politics not to pay fees. And we say, yeah, because if it's friendly project, nothing wrong with it to participate. But from my experience, it was quite shocking when some, I know, I don't want to mention because it mentions the name, because it was resolved in a very funny way. When you start to ask them, okay, we participate, but please fill out the basic form, information about your organization, your level of budget, public or private sponsoring, and please make one sentence why you're not paying. Because you don't feel you have to, you don't have money. It's so easy, guys. Okay, but after that they pay. And not fill it in. So, at least, you know, maybe our position right now that actually our economy was already, because right now I think the situation become better and better. At least project where mostly we participate, it's in two categories. It's kind of projects which we share politics, and then the issue of fee is not relevant, I would say. Or projects which kind of well established and they already somehow adopted the politics of paying fee. But we don't know actually if it's selectively payment or not selectively. So there is no general, because that kind of economy are very untransparent. How much it was paid for this artist, how much for another one. But at the same time, it's completely different task, which it was big discussion inside our collective about that kind of standards. How you can estimate. It's easy to give everyone 200 or 50 euros and then you pay the artist fee. But one artist maybe didn't do anything for that and other really 2 months heavy work. So really difficult to sort. But we try to actually try to find, to narrate that kind of condition of production in art world and cultural economies.
So next, Vlad and Vladan will comment on an initiative which we call the Working Assemblies, and we've organized 3 so far.
We started to discuss about organizing these meetings in different cities across Europe until now. And Russia, yeah, back in spring. I would just like to say that I think that these assemblies, these working assemblies, kind of identified a number of functions. First of all, I think that we're trying to make our platform known and its cases and its members. And then we are trying to liaise with local activist initiatives with the aim of articulating a transnational critical mass of cultural workers. At least this is what emerged in the Berlin Assembly, I would say. And then I think we are trying to raise awareness about the contemporary forms of exploitation and censorship and discuss its local conditions. And also we are trying to find concrete solutions for what we believe to be systemic and structural problems. And also to decide about forms of collective solidarity and action. And I have been personally involved in the organization of the first working assembly, which was in Berlin, and about which I would like to say just a few sentences. I think it was a kind of a happy, I think there were like 2 happy coincidences in regard to this assembly, because first of all, it just happened that a lot of the ArtLeaks platform members happened to be in Berlin with the occasion of the Berlin Biennial. And secondly, because also with the occasion of the Berlin Biennial, there were a lot of similar initiatives from Europe and the States, like Occupy Museums, Arts and Labor, Haben und Brauchen, Rosa Perutz, the Rosa Perutz Collective, and many, many other activists who actually joined our assembly. And I think it was a very interesting meeting in which we discussed a lot of issues. I would advise, if you're interested, to go on our website, which is artleaks.org. We have published reports from all the assemblies. The other 2 assemblies took place in Moscow and Belgrade. I think one of the main actually issues that emerged in Berlin, and what was really interesting was the need to formulate a concrete strategy for articulating an alliance or a coalition of cultural workers from which is actually a transnational coalition. And there has been much talk about that. And actually, after this assembly, we have been in contact, and we have discussion groups taking place. And a lot of things that we discussed there will be reflected on the journal, on the Artlix journal that we have just launched an open call. And I will just say a few words later, but first Vladan will maybe say something about the Belgrade Assembly.
So it is, I think it is very important that Artlix as a project and as a platform is organizing those assemblies in different cities, and especially in the localities and the context, such as, for example, in ex-Yugoslavia, in Serbia, in Belgrade. And for the community there and for the people that are working there, artists and cultural workers, it was very important to have this kind of international input, how the things could be visible, and just to encourage them to speak about their problems there. I think the two major important cases came up very, very soon. It is a highly problematic issue of that Museum of Contemporary Art in Belgrade is not open since 7 years, and it's stopped under reconstruction. So that means that the major institution of art and culture doesn't operate. And just to see what are the problems behind. And another case that was published just recently on the Artlix is a case of Emir Kusturica and his project of ethno villages, because he is basically hijacking all funds of the Ministry of Culture and all kinds of funds. Everything goes to his projects. And if we see this in connection of, for example, that he is very, very good friend of Putin and Nikita Mikhalkov, and I mean, they are personal friends and visitors of his ethno villages, we can connect all this international, let's say, movement from this wing that is going on. And actually, I think we should build a really like international platform and support all these initiatives that have different voice and that try to open up this debate, because it's not so easy to face with these kind of forces that are going on. Another thing, what we also discussed, it is this standardization and different legal. You already mentioned this in this morning. With you in the beginning, with these different laws in different countries and with these different legal determinations that are going on. So in Russia and as well in Serbia, you know, it is written law is not really a practice. And of course, in there is no country where written law is a practice, but at least there is a certain aspects that you need to follow. If we think about killings of the journalists in Serbia and Russia and all these kind of things that are going on in the field of the political and media, then we can imagine that some cases connected to the art and culture are not important in a way that even more worst cases connected to the freedom of speech and the freedom of the individuality. And that is the reason why I think the Artlix should organize different assemblies in different countries, because to get to know the local context and to apply this contextuality later in the practice of Artlix. So this is our idea, not to impose, let's say, some general issues that we should all follow, but really to think about the local context and how things are developed locally, and to connect it with the transnational fight and struggle. So this is my just very brief observation. Thanks.
Thank you. So Vlad will now talk about our forthcoming initiative, which is the Artlix Gazette, which is going to be launched early next year. And it's a publication that we started, and it's totally dedicated to cultural workers' rights and issues of censorship and repression. So I'm just, this is the open call for it on our website.
Yeah. Yeah, I would just mention a couple of ideas which actually articulated this this open call. As I said before, I think that this Gazette is an expression of the assemblies and also the discussions that we had during the assemblies and after the assemblies. And the theme of the first issue of the journal, it's breaking the silence towards justice, solidarity, and mobilization. And actually, we chose this theme, or we thought about this theme, because ArtLeaks' motto is, it's time to break the silence. So we were thinking, actually, what does it mean to break the silence, and what does it bring in the art world? And in relation to this issue of breaking the silence, we had discussions even during the Berlin assembly about how we can actually compare the situation in the art world, where of course everybody knows that there are issues of exploitation and censorship, but nobody talks about them. And we were comparing this to a situation in family, and we were bringing actually the discussion back to psychoanalysis. And so we are going to tackle this theme in the Gazette. Sorry. Yeah. what breaking the silence means is also what we called, and this was another issue that was raised in Berlin, what we think that the politics of truth could be. And this was David Reeves' clear statement. We're really interested in articulating a politics of truth in relation to what is happening currently in the art system, and how these practices of exploitation and censorship are normalized and became their everyday norm in art institutions. And I think that another idea, which is, I'm personally interested in this, it's a kind of return to institutional critique, but not as necessarily as an aesthetic device, but rather as a critical methodology to address issues in relation to the art institutions and how they behave with artists and cultural producers. So I'll just mention the structure of the publications, the Gazette. We have, for the moment, it will be an online Gazette. So we have six sections. The first one is a critique of cultural dominant apparatuses. The second one is a discussion on forms of organization and history of struggles. The third one, which is it's really interesting actually, I think, is the struggle of narrations. And we are interested in those cases which are not blatant cases which can be leaked, but they are rather cases which are rather ambiguous. And so we are trying to see how we can address that. The fourth section refers to a glossary of terms, and this is another thing that emerged in the assemblies, because we think that a political struggle actually has to be carried out also on the field of language, and that we always need to constantly reinvent our vocabulary. And the fifth one is the education, and the sixth one is the best practices, and we're running out of time, okay?
Yeah, so.
Yeah,
so we put on open call, you can read it on our website, and we invite you to send your submissions by December 31st. So we wanted to present just a couple of cases because we are running out of time, and Valentina will talk about our first case, and this is actually the reason why we came together and decided to make ArtLeaks together. So.
Yes, I witnessed the first ArtLeak, what became the first ArtLeak case in Bucharest in the Pavilion UniCredit, which is an art space that it has a overtly leftist political agenda, anarchist library inside, and yet it's financed by UniCredit Bank. And they organized the March 2011 biopolitical branding, just do it. And they invited for the occasion a group of artists that I was starting to work with at the time, post-spectacle, and they have a project of candidating to the Romanian presidential elections. And they were invited with this project in the exhibition, and when they sent the text, which was basically saying that the presidential project dies the moment that enters the art space, because now funded by bank and corporation, we can talk about politics, we are allowed. And when they received this text, the group got kicked out of the exhibition with the excuse that their budget was too high without having any chance to renegotiate. In the same exhibition, the Bureau of Melodramatic Research made a work, We Are the Soul of Sustainability, which consisted in a bank office, the same furniture of the UniCredit. And they published as part of the exhibition the fee that they received, which was 200 euros. And when the director of the space saw it, it aggressed them like verbally and violently the whole afternoon until he changed the cipher with 1,400 euros, calculating, well, the electricity cost, the salaries of people, or whatever. And the artist, the Bureau of Melodramatic Research, didn't come to the opening, and then the curator was fired of the exhibition. On that night, with the post-spectacle, we decided anyway to announce the opening of the exhibition as our performance, so as the presidential candidacy. And so we announced everywhere that the president will be there, and will be there with Dorado, which is very cheap, champagne bottles. And we arrived, we just entered the gallery, four people with the bottle of champagne closed. And Razvanyo, which is the director of the space, started to scream like hell. Like, and this is my house, and you have no right to come here, and I'm gonna call the police. And it took the bottles away and threw them out of the tunnel, and they hit a car and the, whatever, a big scene. And now, and after this case, after we started to protest this case, then Dimitri and other people had similar experiences with the same institution. So that what sparkled the beginning of ArtLeaks. Now to follow up on this, it's. For me, it's very interesting. One, of course, the case of censorship, but also, and there are all these bad practices, especially when you work with people that have the same kind of political agenda, and then you see that the real power structure is completely another story. Now, it's interesting that in places maybe like Russia or Bucharest, this is very clear, but I know maybe more like in Amsterdam or other places, it's much more subtle. So it's. Nobody would scream at you and throw the bottles. They would be, yeah, do your symbolic action now, move out, and then I'm gonna talk with this other guy so that you'll never get invited again. And, you know, it works in a much softer way. So on one side, there is the criticizing the bad practice, but on the other side, there is the chain of exploitation and fear, because somebody to react this way, it means that their only sustainability is the bank, and if the bank stops giving money, has to close the space, and so it means that the precarity of working condition is not only in the artist situation, but also in the institutional situation. And when we think of organizing ArtLeaks, then it shouldn't become, yes, a police that marks the good practice or the bad practice, or what defines the artwork and what are the conditions we have to work for. But it has to become a platform for which another form of cooperation is possible. Because the problem with this chain of exploitation is that cooperation becomes impossible. Because although Razvanyon might be able to talk about these things, he read those books, you know, he knows what we're talking about. And yet, it is impossible to have a public discussion about it because there is too much at stake, there is too much fear. So could ArtLeaks, in connection with all these other platforms that are already working, provide a sort of safety for cooperation to happen? And that doesn't mean unionizing, it can mean very different things. It can mean also carrying out a struggle for non-exploitative working conditions, not only for artists, which for me would be interesting also.
Okay, so we have to wrap up, so Joanna wants to have some comments.
Thank you. Thank you so much. It seems like you're opening a Pandora box. And I also would suggest, because there is also this open marathon, that you schedule one of the meetings further to discuss the cases, because I think all of us, we have really a lot to say about this. And I have to say that also working on Berlin Biennale once, I thought, what if we would just exhibit the budget? And this would be probably the most exciting part of the whole project, you know, and most visible, I'm sure. And it's amazing how untransparent are and non-standardized are conditions in which we are working. And it's also very important to link all these grant organizations together, and also organizations that Gregory was bringing yesterday, and looking, for example, at our Workers' Coalition or other people who have done it 20, 30, 40 years ago, and like not start anew, but use like Occupy Museums are, for example, protesting in MoMA today because Occupy Art Workers Coalition lobbied on MoMA to have a day for free. That's why they can go inside and do it. You know, so I think it's super important to look upon us in one system. And so thank you very much, and really please let's continue in the open marathon and the last part of our blog. And please stay. Maybe we'll have 3 or 4 minutes at the end to sum up. And I would like to invite Katharina Lenz from Wochenklausur, who will present and revisit the action that actually was performed here in 1995 in Steirische Herbst before Veronica and Florian were working here, and which was dealing with, it was called immigrant labor issues. So now we will revisit this action and we will look at the legal system and the change of legal system and see if this kind of actions would be possible today and under which circumstances. Katharina, please join us here. Corina, maybe you can take a seat here. Katharina is an artist, one of the former members of Wochenklausur and very active with the collective. Till which year have you been working with Wochenklausur? And we were of course part of the action in 1995. Jana
said already, this was a project carried out in 1995, which led my little daughter, who is 7 years old, to ask me yesterday how old she was when I was working on this, because I was preparing the talk. So I said, well, she wasn't born then, and I didn't even know her father. So it's a long time ago, but I think still some of these issues are very, very present until today. I will tell you about the project, how a collective of artists, of 7 artists, managed in 9 weeks to legalize some illegal immigrants in Austria. And I will build it up in 4 points. I will just tell the story of the project first. Then, as actually this chair, or one chair besides me, was reserved for Mr. Vacarescu, a lawyer who aided us back then in 95, but because of illness he had to cancel the meeting today. I will try to sum up some of the legal aspects as a second point, although I am not a lawyer. Then I will try to explain a little bit the working methodology of Wochenklausur, and in the end we will come to the point whether this action would be possible today. The points become shorter, so don't worry, I think we will keep in the time. First, when we set up the project, we didn't just come to Graz like that. We were invited by the Steirische Herbst, so I'm returning to the point of initial point here. Because of the theme of the Steirische Herbst in 95, which was art is over, the game goes on. So Hoske Hathabel, who then was the director of the festival, thought that Wochenklausur would make a good point here, because it was already known for some social concrete interventions trying to stretch the concept of art as far as possible into real social and political space. So what we did, as in the projects before, was find an office, because the formal aspects of Wochenklausur are very conventional, just some people working in an office. We needed space for that. We needed accommodation for 7 people for 9 weeks. And then we started to investigate what theme could be in the center for this intervention. And soon it became very clear that due to the space where we had located our office, immigrant issues were very hot, because lots of immigrants lived around there. And researching, doing deep research into the legal situation, it became clear that it's kind of a vicious circle, that people having legal access to being in Austria, had a residency permit, were often, or more often, not allowed to work here because they would not get a work permit. So it seemed like a challenge to us as artists to find a gap or some kind of loophole in this legislation and try to make it possible for some immigrants at least to work here legally, because without work, as we all know, there's no integration into society. You don't make a living, and it's very hard to survive. So doing this deep research, we found out 2 possibilities. One was that self-employed one-person businesses could actually work without a work permit, because the work permits quota were only valid for employed workers. And the second one was that artists, interestingly, were exempted from the quota, and it was possible for them to work here even without a residency permit. We assume that it was mainly thinking of performing or musician artists, because that is very often the case when they come for a short season to work in Austria, then it's just too much of a fuss to get a work and a residency permit. So trying to get deeply into this artist exemption point, we set up a scheme that was quite complex to put together. Can we go to the next image? Maybe I'll try to show you, taking this microphone. On your right-hand side, we have in the center the artist. We tried to make artists out of illegal immigrants, using the law that said that if someone can prove that he or she is able to subsidize himself just with the income out of art, then he or she may stay in Austria. So what we needed were artists who could prove they could live out of their art. As many of you as artists know, that's quite difficult to do. But with a commission, something like a contract for a commissioned artwork, that could work. So we needed sponsors to commission pieces of art to an artist. So the sponsor also had to be very rich, because to finance somebody to stay here for a while, it needs quite a lot of money. So we needed shareholders, because it was clear that probably we would not find easily just single persons to finance this. So on the top there, we have the shareholders who would contribute the money needed to pay for the piece. And what the piece would be needed to be contributed by a relief organization, which we find here, who would advise the sponsor what the so-called social sculpture, social plastic, would consist of. We thought that refugees coming out of a persecution situation for religious, ethnic, or political reason would have a highest interest in aiding people in need in their home countries or in other places. So the point was that our artists were commissioned to make a social sculpture that would last 1 year. The amount of money, the cost of the commission, was exactly the amount of money that was asked for by law, so somebody could prove he or she could live out of the outcome of art. plus the social insurance. And we limited this project to 1 year because it was we were limited to 9 weeks in our project, and it seemed a viable middle way to provide enough time for people to make contacts that would then last longer if they would be helped by the sponsors for a whole year. And also it would be short enough so we could finance it, because one artist package would cost 7,500 euro. We managed to do 7 of them. Now we can go to the next. One was about collecting as many toys as possible for an orphanage in Sarajevo. This was a Vietnamese artist, and for one whole year he collected toys. And then they were brought by a relief organization to Sarajevo. So the next one. This is a whole load of baby food that was collected by Hoshi Mohiden, a Kurdish-Iraqi artist, who then would have it transported to the Kurdish areas in northern Iraq, where it was very much needed. As next, we have school and teaching and learning materials for schools in Bosnia, collected by Bosnian artist Miralem Skalovic. And the next one is an artist from Liberia, Tom Simpson, who repaired bicycles. And after the 10th bicycle, he passed on the project to a Turkish artist. He and carried through this with the aid of a sponsor who was the Students' Union of Austria, and they collected the shares from students, professors, and teachers in the University of Graz. So we managed to put together these 7 packages, and actually these 7 people, which seems like a very small number, but at least we could show up an exemption in the law, really gained legal status in Austria. So now we'll go to the next. I'll just try to explain a little bit more thoroughly the legal implications of this. The one thing is the freedom of art that I'm very glad Jakob already talked to us quite a lot. Just to add an information, in Austria, it was just added in 1982 to the constitution, where it makes just an addendum to the freedom of science. So then in 82 it was added that the making, the distribution, and the teaching of art is free. So that, of course, was one point that we wanted to link up to. Both for our own project, that what we were doing was art, and then, of course, even more for the artists, linking up also to this point that nobody is to say or decide or define what art is, which, of course, becomes difficult if then there would be a judgment, because then, as we heard already, mostly experts are called in and they have to decide whether this is art or not after their own definition. As we know, there are many different concepts of art. In this case, we tried to make sure that it was considered as art by reassuring several aspects. It was Steirische Herbst, as a very well-renowned art institution, that invited us and was sponsoring the whole project. That was one point, a signal that this was connected to art. As a second thing, many of the sponsors that we found were also related to the art world or were otherwise very well-renowned institutions, like the Pedagogic Academy of Graz, or the University, or Forum Stadtpark, another public gallery in Graz. So just by that, these people or institutions making the commissions would assure that they would have thought thoroughly before they bought a piece of art, quite expensive maybe, for 7,500 euro. And the third point was that One characteristic of art, very conventionally, still is that it is presented in a gallery space. To prove that, we made an agreement with Christine Frisingelli, who was the director in the following year of Steirische Herbst in 96, who then agreed with us that the results of these social plastics were presented in an exhibition space in Palais Athems, a very posh palace in Graz. So we asserted many different points that if it would come to a trial, it would make sure that this is really art. Of course, one more point was that the media are much more accessible to art than to illegal immigrants. So we could reach media access and had media reporting about the project and a lot of discussion about it. And it was discussed on the art pages, but also in other contexts. So that's about the art aspect. In terms of immigration laws, it was really apparent that it was very inhuman, because this fact that lots of people live here with a status that allows them to live here, as long as they can prove that they can make a living. But without a work permit, they cannot work legally. And if they're caught not having work, then even the residency permit just is extinguished. So this makes a circle that is very hard to break. And back then in 95, there was a fixed quota of 9% of the officially employed Austrians that was reserved for foreign labor force. The project took place in Herbst, in the autumn. We started in August, but we knew that we very soon learned that the quota had already been filled in spring. And after that, not one single permit would be issued anymore. So it was true that we wouldn't find another way to employ immigrants anywhere, because even if there was lack of workforce, we just would not get a work permit. Okay, so now let's go to the working method. As a group of seven highly motivated people, as you probably know, who are ready to work 24 hours a day, or at least 20, it is possible to carry through such a thing in 9 weeks. Often we hear the comment that why aren't you then social workers or politicians or what else, anything else? But the interesting thing is that there is a very conventional view of art as being, or artists as being, the innovative people with the innovation spirit and creativity. So why not use that creativity for real social and political change? So a working method that allows for dividing into subgroups, who then with one person being just in charge of the media, or one person just in charge of getting sponsorship or the money, and other people doing the lobbying with the political level, with the economic level, with whoever you need to lobby with, makes it possible to really be an expert, actually, in a field in a very short time. So, and there I maybe wanted to come back to a point that Hans made when he said that he was temporarily a Turkish artist. This is an aspect that is typical for these projects too, that temporarily we become experts in a certain field. Temporarily we become experts in immigration law and in immigration issues. Have the very close contact to immigrants, the close contact to lawyers, contact to politicians who are usually dealing with this, but as we think, not enough and not well enough. Okay, now, yes, you can go to the next. The point that we were working in the framework of the Steirische Herbst was very important, because thus we could prove that it was taking place in the frame of art. And we also had public presentations. So usually we do media or press presentations, but also public days of visit where people, just the public audience of the festival, could come by and discuss with us whether this is art or not. That was a very common discussion, whether it's good art or not, but that's up to anybody to decide, or everybody for himself or herself to decide. But it makes a great difference from, let's say, social workers, because they don't get the public coming by and asking them what they're working on. They don't get the press there. So it's a very good way to use art to do such kind of interventions. And now, as the last thing, I just wanted to show two short images about the exhibition. It was made up in a very simple way, as you see, just in wood, put up some cases, and showing symbolically all the seven social sculptures. Here we have the example of the toys that went to the orphanage in Sarajevo. And at the next one, we have children's clothes that went to a refugee camp in Tuzla. So that also, just by just making a very simple architecture for an exhibition and putting symbolically a couple of pieces there, it was enough to prove that these were artists. And what really is important is that after that 1 year, not only one of them stayed or was allowed to stay here for longer. Three of the participants managed to stay in Austria. Two of them work as artists. One is internationally active as a photographer. One is now the one who, the second one, repaired the bicycles, is now a car mechanic in Germany. And some of them returned to their home countries, mainly the Bosnians, because when the war was over. So that's, in short, the project. The question whether this project would be possible today has a very short answer: no. Because in 2006, the Austrian legislation was changed, and since then, this gap has been just shut. So it's not possible to go this way now, which doesn't say that Wochenklausur would not try to find another gap. So, because that's part of the methodology of the group, to always try the possible that is feasible in a very short time inside of the impossible. So that's, I think that's a good closing point. Let's see if there are questions.
Thank you, Katarina. It has been really fantastic presentation. And and really show, and I think it goes also for all of us here, that if we as cultural producers are also very well prepared in the legal terms, we can really empower art and to make art into a real tactic or a real tool within the social sphere. And we have we are just very, very short on time. If and I would suggest also that if it's okay for you, that we go to the continuity room, and maybe there are other discussions, but maybe let's take one last question before closing the block. Yes, or a comment. So please speak loud.
Many of them, my friends, don't live anymore. They are not. who are outside Schengen area and who live in places like Syria and who are really repressed and endangered and lose their lives. At the same time, they don't get the minimal support to raise their voice in Europe, to show their films, to give lectures. Also at this event, there is nobody sitting here without Schengen citizenship from Syria, for example. And also in other events, I organized the
Excuse me, I would propose that we go now together and continue also with to discuss together.
I just have to respect
that there is another blog and lecture starting here.
Just let me finish my sentence because I organized one event in Basel, which was really a very well-known event, Art Basel. It was radio streaming and nobody was allowed to enter Schengen area from Syria. And I organized in Budapest, so this is not the first time I face these walls. And I really would like to appreciate if all those who sit here, they could do something against the situation. Thank you, sorry.
Yeah. Thank you. And so thank you very much again, all the participants of the blog. It has been fascinating 3 hours, and thank you for active participation. And for those of you who would like to continue talking, let's just move to the continuity room. Thank you.